Hello, my health freedom loving friends. Misty Carlfeld here with Health Freedom Idaho, and I am here with attorney Colton Boyles. And Colton, I don't know if you know this or not, but you are quickly becoming Idaho's favorite attorney.
That's scary.
Well, it's because you are a constitutional attorney, and people can see that you are coming at these ridiculous, tyrannical mandates from a constitutional perspective and really with a concern for our children. So we just appreciate you. I'm going to speak on behalf of Idahoans. We appreciate you.
Thanks, Misty. But true religion is visiting widows and orphans in their distress. And so if we don't take that call seriously, we'll be held accountable one day, whether in this life or the next.
Yeah, amen to that. Well, today we're discussing the mask requirements that seem to be happening all over the state. Cities, city councils are talking about it. Districts are talking about it. Counties, county commissioners are talking about it. The mayor of Boise just made a requirement. And I just want to bring to people's attention that you have to read the whole thing. It looks like it's required, but if you read the whole thing, you can see that you're required to wear it if you cannot maintain a 6-foot distance from others, or a first responder, or have health concerns. So basically, nothing will change for me. I have an autoimmune disease, and I require fresh oxygen. So, you know, so, but let's say some people don't apply to that, right? What would you say is your perspective on the constitutionality of these mask requirements so that people are armed with their rights, whether they have an autoimmune disease or not, like me?
Yeah, I'm reading this over the last day or two. And I know, I think it's really interesting. This is just another bait and switch by a bunch of the cronies and this little cabal of globalist people trying to take our country over, and they have know nothing about civil liberties or understand why this country is great, and they're ruining it. And they can't write. I mean, they can't even craft a basic document that meets constitutional muster. So you look at after the now, therefore, on page 2, it says that face coverings are required. That's very interesting. So you know, we live in a Christian society and we don't have the idea of face coverings. There's some scriptures in the Bible that require that, you know, that say women should cover their head and things like that. And people debate that. But when have we ever required face coverings in the United States? In fact, it's a crime certain times to wear a face covering and then engage in criminal activity. But I guess that's what they want us to do because it will protect us from the virus. But it's just a face covering, and they don't even require or tell you what to wear. So their own words are, completely cover their nose and mouth. Mm-hmm. So does this work? Right? Can you take your shirt and pull your shirt up?
Right.
Does this protect you from the virus? Right? Can I do this? They don't define what a face covering is. Is it a surgical mask? Is it a mask you wear when you mow the lawn or where you paint your house? So, I mean, this on its face is just, it's just void. It's void for vagueness, and it cannot be enforced, in my opinion. And there's Supreme Court precedent on point here, and I'll read you a little clip so people can find it themselves. Musser v. Utah, 333 U.S. 95 from 1948. Grayned versus City of Rockford, 408 U.S. 104. Village of Hoffman Estates versus the Flip Side, 455 U.S. 489. That's a 1972 and a 1982 case. It say, quote, the vagueness may be from uncertainty in regard to persons within the scope of the act. Well, this is every person, so that's not vague. But there's vagueness later when they say who's exempt. Or in regard to the applicable test to ascertain guilt. So they're going to say it's a misdemeanor if you don't cover your face. But that doesn't apply. But they didn't define it, right? Vague laws often offend several important values. First, because we assume that man is free to steer between lawful and unlawful conduct, we insist that laws give the person of ordinary intelligence a reasonable opportunity to know what is prohibited so that he may act accordingly. Vague laws may trap the innocent by not providing fair warnings. Second, if arbitrary and discriminatory enforcement is to be prevented, laws must provide explicit standards for those who apply them. A vague law impermissibly delegates basic policy matters to policemen, judges, and juries for resolution on an ad hoc and subjective basis with the attendant dangers of arbitrary and discriminatory applications. Now that involves the separation of powers again. And why is the court worried about basic policy matters being exercised by law enforcement and the judiciary? Because that's what the legislature is supposed to do. And we have a scourge of a lack of understanding of that in our state right now. So this just on its face in its first paragraph is laughable. And then when you go read the exceptions, the same thing holds. What's the rationale for them saying children under five? What about a 5.5-year-old? How are they going to tell? Are you supposed to carry a birth certificate around? You look at two, persons who cannot medically tolerate it. Well, I was unaware that medical toleration was the standard either federally in Idaho. I thought that there were statutes and laws that applied to that, including the ADA, which requires that businesses that are open to the public provide a reasonable accommodation for people with disabilities, which, by the way, can include a communicable or contagious disease, right? Think about that for a second. Because of COVID, you have to wear a mask, but you can't wear a mask because you have asthma and you have COVID, but you don't have to tell them any of that. There's also the Idaho Human Rights Act that protects people from that. That statute is 675909, and it applies to businesses. So they need to get with their attorney and talk about how they could potentially get wrapped up into lawsuits for discrimination. The prohibitions to discriminate also apply to individuals without disabilities who are associated with a person with a disability. There's another nice nugget in the statute people don't know about. So if I'm there with my kid and he has asthma and he can't wear a mask, does the prohibition to discriminate apply to me or not? That's an interesting question. This goes on and on. Talk about the informed consent laws. That's 39-4503. And it comprehends the need for the nature of and the significant risks ordinarily inherent in any contemplated hospital, medical, dental, surgical, or other healthcare treatment or procedure, right? So you have the ability under Idaho state law to consent to that care. And the definition of consent in 39-4502, paragraph 7, includes refusal to consent to care and or withdrawal of care. Another interesting thing to note is that in paragraph 10, a healthcare provider means any person or entity otherwise authorized by law to administer health care in the ordinary course of business. Seems like declaring an emergency and operating the government and mandating a face covering is them operating in the ordinary course of their business. You know, nothing in that chapter two of the consent chapter, this quote says, is construed to permit or require the provision of health care for a patient in contravention of the patient's stated or implied objection thereto upon religious grounds, nor shall anything in this chapter be construed to require the granting of permission for or on the behalf of any patient who is not able to act for himself by his parent, spouse, or guardian in violation of the religious beliefs of the patient or the patient's parent or spouse. You know, and so we've got the medical issue and we've got the religious issue, and then we've got the federal layer and the state layer, and those all got to be read together, and they come together, and it's really complicated. But when I read this order, I don't sense a sensitivity to that in the language. The language does not reflect that. Take a look at exemption. What is this? 6 and 7. You're exempt from this, I think, facially vague and discriminatory Boise public health emergency order requiring face coverings. If you are in an outdoor public place where people can employ social distancing as recommended by CDC, it doesn't say where people are. It says where people can. And then you got to go look up the CDC recommendations. Well, what's recommended by the CDC? Here again, we're incorporating the CDC guideline. We don't know what it is. That's vague on its face. What about 7? Indoor recreational facilities, which they say means gyms and fitness.
Unbelievable.
Where people can employ. Mm-hmm. What about churches? Are they not an indoor facility? So I guess you just always have to wear a face covering in church, even if you could socially distance. And, you know, the problem with that is if I take Boise to court and I win, it's a mandatory attorney fee provision. So, I mean, if I was a taxpayer down there, I'd be hot because this is just easy pickings, you know? So people really got to stand up. We can provide all these citations. They need to read them. The reason they have those exemptions in there is because there's like an attorney who's probably getting run over in the office telling them, we need to make sure we put exemptions in here or we're going to have a whole host of potential problems. Not only loss of qualified immunity where you sue that person individually, like that individual person that works in the government, the mayor individually, right? But you also get to sue them in their official capacity, meaning you have the deep pockets of the city or the state. That's your taxpayer money. So I know I dumped a lot on you. I got more. We've got the Idaho constitutional prohibitions restricting the religious discrimination. I got cites to ADA, Americans with Disabilities Act, that require the reasonable accommodations for places open to the public. You know, that's part 36201. You know, you just cannot discriminate on the basis of a disability. It's not, the standard is not medical toleration. The standard is set forth in the law already, and that we should be expecting them to follow the law, and there should be consequences if they don't.
Yes. Okay. And I would assert that the human condition requires oxygen. So therefore we are all needing oxygen. So I think people should keep that in mind. It doesn't have to just be for people with asthma to invoke their right, but or people like me. The humanity needs oxygen to breathe and to be healthy. And we've made some really good articles on that on healthfreedomidaho.org that people can check out. I've been asked this question several times today. Does a person have to be ticketed or arrested for wearing a mask in order to sue? Or can someone bring a lawsuit against the mayor for this on its face?
That question is always, of course you can bring a lawsuit. But there's risk to that. You could lose. You could be held accountable for paying the other side's attorney fees. There's a lot of anxiety. There's a lot of time. There's a lot of balancing that goes into whether we want to engage in litigation or not. But to answer the question, you know, how does this apply to a homeless person who doesn't have a home and lives in a public space, right? Is there an accommodation for them? Are they required to wear a mask? They can't afford a mask. And also, when we're talking about enforcing this order, do you have to wait to sue? No, the courts have held for a long time, it's black letter law, that the threat of prosecution is enough. And there's federal declaratory judgment acts and there's state declaratory judgment acts. And the courts and the legislature, their policy is to have people go find out what the permissible conduct is first, so that way they're not left with the choice of, you know, breaking a contract or committing a crime, right? We want to have that measure there to relieve that sort of rock in a hard place where people will get. But you read this Boise Public Health Emergency Order 2010 from July 2, and they say under the penalty enforcement provision that in accordance with Boise City Code Section 115.10, any person who violates the provision of the emergency order is guilty of a misdemeanor, prison, fine, or both. Well, what's the maximum fine? What's the maximum imprisonment, right? Well, I guess we're supposed to go to Section Chapter 15, Title 1, on page 1 of the order under their fourth whereas. Apparently, there's a March 17 ordinance that was repealed and replaced in full on April 7th. That the city of Boise, their council, adopted an ordinance enacting a new Chapter 15, Title 1, quote, setting forth the authority, purpose, and intent of emergency powers to address the threat of COVID-19. So I thought I'd get on there this morning and go to Boise City website, see if I could find it. It's not there. So I go to Sterling Codifiers, who manages Boise's copyrighted city code. It's not there. They direct you to call the city clerk. I call the city clerk. No one answered the phone. So I guess you just have to fill out this little contact us and request it. Or citizens are supposed to fill out a public records request to get the code. But as of right now, it's not up there. So talk about my void for vagueness argument. We don't even know what the law is unless you, you know, go to the city council and were there and they gave you a copy. I mean, are they distributing these to anyone? Are they putting these out with this public health emergency? Are we supposed to rely on the media to communicate this information to us? I mean, I'm really just flabbergasted, Misty, and I'm really concerned about where this is going and how these people are acting. They're out of control, and it's this is dangerous. This is very dangerous.
It is dangerous, and I'm outraged. I'm outraged that they are doing this right around our Independence Day, the celebrations of our independence. And they're specifically saying they're doing it on purpose around those days because they know we will be gathering. They know we will be celebrating. They know we will be traveling. So they're purposely doing this around and beforehand of our Independence Day celebrations. So I'm actually going to wrap this up because I'm on my way to a protest. I don't know if you saw, but there was like over 200 people saying they were going today, and we had over 600 shares, almost 700 shares, because people are outraged at the tyranny that is taking place in our great state of Idaho and at our capital down here in Boise. So, absolutely. Well, thank you so much. You want to tell everybody about your law firm?
Boyles Law. We're in Sandpoint, Idaho. Give us a call if you need our help. We're happy to refer you out to someone who's close and can help you. And we really need to build a huge consensus of freedom, kind, loving people. And, you know, it's no longer enough to go out there and try and keep up with the Joneses and get the American dream and buy your white picket fence house and buy your boat. You're going to have to go out and you're going to have to make a difference. Get involved in your local politics. Figure out a way to contribute. Because we're getting close. As a student of history, we've got like 8 of the 10 Marxist, you know, requirements to take our country over and become communists. So it's going to be up to you to hold on to those last two.
What are the last two? Do you know them off the top of your head?
Well, one of them is like a total takeover of the educational system by the state. And the other one is, you know, I think moving to a totally digital currency where we no longer even have the Federal Reserve notes that are loaned to the United States, but we have like a tracking system that's tied into the money. So I think those are kind of the last two main ones they're doing.
Wow.
And obviously the forced medical procedures, that's, I just already consider having lost that because now they're actually doing that one.
Right. Right. Well, thank you again for your time, Colton. I'm going to get down there to the protest, and I know you have a lot of work to do. We're keeping you busy. Thank you so much.
Stay safe.
Thanks.